Amazing. Thank you for that song. Welcome, everybody. Like I said, my name's Sophia. I'm going to be sort of chairing tonight's event on Socialism 101, Can Art Change the World? I think there's still a few people trying to get into the Zoom room. There was a cap, so you guys are the lucky 100 who have made it into the room. So congratulations. And just how this event's going to be run, we've got two fantastic speakers. We've got Noel Halifax, who is a member of the SWP, was an activist in the Gay Liberation Front and has done lots of writing about artwork in the 20th century online on Socialist Worker, which you can find some of his articles. And we're also joined by Zak Cochrane, who's also a member of the Socialist Workers Party, but an activist as well in Love Music, Hate Racism. So we're going to be having a conversation between the three of us for about 45 minutes, and then it'll be open up to discussion, questions, contributions from anybody who wants to. So let's get cracking. I'm just going to share a PowerPoint slide with you all and get that set up. And what we're going to do first is actually watch a really recent video from Banksy. I'm sure we all know who Banksy is. It's his most recent piece of artwork, and it's a little bit of a take on Bob Ross, who people might know. He's a sort of artist who's not known for his political artwork at all from the 1980s, but it's a little bit of a joke, and actually a lot of people were watching Bob Ross when it was being shown on the BBC during lockdown. But I thought it would be a really appropriate video to start off the event with today, because it's clearly about how artwork can be seen as a sign of a political act. So hopefully it's not too loud for people, but we're going to watch this little 3 minute video.
Hello, I'm Bob Ross. I'd like to welcome you to the joy of painting. Got all your materials out? Ready to do a fantastic painting with me? Good.
So I tell you what, let's just take off and have some fun today. I thought we'd just do a very warm little scene that makes you feel good in here.
Hey, I gotta make a big decision here. Maybe he lives right here.
A little shadow right underneath there. Darker, darker, darker down here. No pressure. If you like to use pattern, trace your pattern on here. A little bit of white to that. I don't want to lighten it just a little. Oh, that's much better. Easy. Shoo. Caress it very lightly. All right, we're in business again here. Change the shape of this a little bit so it has a little more character to it. You can do that. That's a nice color. There. A little back in here, just like so. Oh, that's perfect. Perfect.
This is really a fun little painting. It should give you a lot of ideas for a lot of crazy things that you can do.
Okay, just right on down. But think about shape and form and how you want the limbs to look. Also, there's a nice light area between the darks. It separates, makes everything really stand out and look good. Let's go right up in here. Maybe we'll have a little water in here. I love water. I just want to flavor this a little. Barely touch it. Barely touch it.
All right. The paints that we use are specifically designed for this technique of painting. There we go.
Go back in here. Maybe a little ripple here and there and there and here. That's all there is to it. There. Something like so.
Painting, to me, represents freedom. I can create the kind of world that I want to see and that I want to be part of.
Look at that. Isn't he a cute little rascal?
Big son of a gun. He just goes all the way off the canvas.
We just want to show you a technique and turn you loose on the world. Just absolutely turn you loose on the world. That really is the fun part of this whole technique. So from all of us here, I'd like to wish you happy painting and God bless my...
So that was a little Banksy take on Bob Ross. And in the words of Bob Ross, painting can be about freedom and about, you know, envisioning a world that you want to be in. So obviously that Banksy piece was an ode to Oscar Wilde, who was imprisoned in Reading Jail for being LGBTQ+. And we can see his expression of freedom and angst in not his paintings, but his literature and poetry and so on. And of course, there's such a wealth of political art. So that's the first question I'd like to ask our speakers today. I'm going to come to you first, Noel, and then to Zak. But why is it important for Marxists to talk about art and culture, and what does Marxism have to say about all forms of culture, whether that be music, art, dance, and protest, and so on?
Oh, sorry. Well, how could it not? I mean, another word for Marxism, historical materialism. And so I think Marxism, there's two things when you look at culture, art generally. First of all, when you look at some past pieces of art, it can put it into the context of that time. And some of the best pieces of art have been from revolutionary periods. I mean, you see now, whether it's the French Revolution or the Russian Revolution, both of them, another word for revolution, Festival of the Oppressed, has been an explosion of artistic experimentation and people dreaming of what the world would be like now they can change it and change the status quo. So art, music, even dance come to the fore when people, we can look, using Marxist, you can look back what art meant at the time, what the context it was, and pieces of art become quite staid and formal now. You don't realise that they were in their time a symbol of revolt and revolution and fighting oppression. And the best pieces of art that last over time often have that, because society is a history of class society. And so even under feudal times, there was revolutionary art, the bourgeois revolution. You can see the art was fomented over hundreds of years, and the Enlightenment was the slow growth of the new society existed by the old that burst forth in various revolutions, the most famous being the French Revolution, but there was the English Civil War, other periods of which there's been very ferment, and you see art blossoming out. The other thing is why art is so important is that I was, even from the early days, art has been a way in which people express and change their ideas about society generally. I mean, some people do come to politics and to revolutionary change by reading political tracts or Socialist Worker. Please do read Socialist Worker, I think you shouldn't. But many more people come to it through forms of art. In the 20th century, I thought music was the most important of the art forms. Certainly in the second half of the 20th century to the 21st century, music is the dominant art form. That hasn't always been the same. In other periods, in the bourgeois period, poetry was very, very important and very popular. And we look at the moment at pictures of David, Michelangelo's David, which is now, you know, the classic piece of classic beauty. It's famous for its homoerotic nature, but in fact, it was made to celebrate the victory of the Florence Republic, where the people of Florence rose up to overthrow their ruler and declare a republic with some form of democracy. And it was from the story of David and Goliath. Goliath that David defeated is of course the old hierarchy of Florence, and David was the new republic. So it was commissioned by the Republic of Florence at their brief period when they still were overthrown later. It was a symbol of a revolt against the status quo and oppression. And that was, David was built to represent that. And you can see many other in the French Revolution, there's lots of, maybe we'll look at the next picture.
I think that's Zak, but this is the French Revolution here, you know.
And there is, the French Revolution is another example where you see many famous aspects of art reflect and come from the revolution. And in fact, the revolution itself, the artist David, he more or less created the style on which revolution became known for. The brand image of the revolution was created by the painter David. David was also one of the people who signed the execution notice for the execution of the king. So politics and art are interwoven, and you can understand why some pieces of art have such hold on us. More is because we live in a class-ridden society, but past societies have also been class-ridden. And that contradiction between repression and hope and dreams can be expressed in art that's in ways that touch us as deeply as a political tract or an article And so films or paintings, and in the early part of the 19th century, poetry, actually very, very important with poetry in expressing the hopes of people in new society. People like Byron and Shelley, of course, both wrote revolutionary poems, but were hugely, hugely widely read. And it was the same in Germany. Romantic poets like Schiller, who was censored at the time. So, for example, again, I suppose what's now seen as expression, the theme tune of bourgeois liberalism, is Beethoven's Ninth Symphony with the famous song, you know, Ode to Joy, which is now the national anthem of the EU. That is, in fact, based on a poem by Schiller, Ode to Joy. What's that all about? Well, the first poem was originally called Ode to Freedom, but it was censored by the Prussian state. So the original poem, it wasn't Ode to Joy, it was Ode to Freedom. It was a call for bourgeois freedoms against the oppressive Prussian state at the time. And you can see that many works of art have this contradiction in them. That's why I think it's important to see why art moves us and how it continues to do so, and how people express their hopes for a new society in art forms other than just political tracts. And that's why it's important for us to understand and to celebrate.
Thanks for that, Noel. We'll be coming back to you very shortly. I'm going to come to Zak now. I'd like to ask you the same question. In your eyes, why do you think it's important for Marxists to celebrate art and culture?
There's a key concept as Marxists that we follow, and that is the existing of all, the history of all hitherto existing societies has been one of class struggle. And I think it's absolutely crucial that we look at art in the same way as following this quote, because art is an expression of social relations in any given society. You have a dominant class that tries to assert their will through art forms, but they don't always have it their own way, is the truth. It's contested, it's a tug of war between the masses and the ruling class. And Leon Trotsky, I put a quote on your screens, I think he makes really valid points when he says, every ruling class creates their own culture and consequently its own art as a way of establishing their dominance. He said this: the fundamental processes of the growth of bourgeois culture and of its crystallization into style were determined by the characteristics of the bourgeoisie as a possessing and exploiting class. The bourgeoisie not only developed materially within feudalism, feudal society, intertwining itself in various ways with the latter and attracting wealth into its own hands, but it weaned the intelligentsia to its side and created its cultural foundations, schools, universities, academies, newspapers, magazines, long before it openly took possession of the state. So art is crucial for any dominant class and any class that wants to overthrow a dominant class, actually, in terms of establishing hegemony. It's absolutely crucial. John Berger, the classic Marxist historian who's no longer with us, looked at 15th to 19th century oil paintings and made the point that they were adapted to depict objects and humans as private property, again sending us message through arts about the nature of capitalist relations. To go back to this point, they don't always have it their own way, and I think today will be about us showing you examples of actually where resistance comes to the established order. But just to end on this, I think art gives us a glimpse of a future kind of society, what Bob Ross absolutely explained. Our creativity is disconnected because as wage slaves, we're not in control of what's produced in society. Actually, art gives us just a small glimpse of what a future social society could look like, where production and human creativity are connected again.
Cheers. Thanks for that, Zak. So obviously we've had a little introduction as to why it's important for Marxists to talk about art, but now we're going to take some time with both speakers to go into a few more in-depth examples of art movements, mainly from the 20th century. We know how often these art movements and expressions come through struggle, and we often look at these events through a historic lens, but actually this time today we're going to be looking through them through the lens of art and culture and how they offered a commentary on society at that time. time. So Noel, I'm going to come back to you first. Of course, we know much of the greatest artworks are, of course, expressions of revolutions like we just saw before. But I'm going to hand over to you now to talk about some of the examples of 20th century art that you thought were particularly important and which offered a critique of capitalism and society at that time.
Right, okay, so here we have example of Dada, because really since the beginning of the 20th century, one way or another, bourgeois society, capitalist society has come from crisis to crisis. And the massive big start of the 20th century was the First World War, which ripped apart the Victorian, Edwardian complacency and the art had gone before, where everything is settled and established, everything was nice, paintings should be pretty to decorate, and society was deemed to be stable and progressing would happen slow and forever. And then we get the First World War. And the First World War was barbaric. The whole notions of this nice, settled progression, we're going to get nicer and nicer, was shattered. And it shattered the art world as well. And so one reaction to that horror was the Dada movement, started in by people running away from the war in Switzerland and Geneva. It started off as a sort of poetry and plays and performance and art performance, and then moved to Berlin. And when it came to Berlin, what was then the budding German Revolution, which burst out after the Bolshevik Revolution, Berlin, Germany Revolution 1919, and so they were affected by that, a huge big uplift of society, the soldiers and the Navy mutinied, there was workers' council springing up, everybody thought the revolution from Russia would spread to Germany. It didn't, that's another long story, but that was the atmosphere at the time and the art reflected it. So the Dada, when they came to Berlin, became much more political from being much more abstract in their revolt against the establishment as it had been initially. It then became much more directly, politically and blunt. So when the Dada first came to Berlin, for example, their first exhibition they had, at the time, there was this right-wing myth going around, one that Hitler fed on later, that Germany had lost the war because it'd been betrayed, that the generals had been betrayed, and that if they'd gone on a bit longer, they would have won it. And the first exhibition the Dadaists had, apart from the artwork, which was very radical and was breaking the conventions of the what we would call Victorian, Edwardian pretty pictures, they had a decorated from the roof, they hung dead pigs. And they put the pig corpses in the uniforms of German generals, dripping blood. And if you look at their artwork at the time, whether it be Gross or Hartfield, it was always directly political. Here we have Hannah Hoch, who was a famous out lesbian at the time. And that's the other aspect of Berlin. The revolution, though it didn't succeed, it did create a semi-liberated zone for and there was a very large commercial LGBT gay scene in Berlin, and also the new art with a new way of expressing things. The idea that things have been shattered by the war, that society is shattered and divided, and the art reflected that. And if you go to Hartfield, we saw before, when the Nazis started to rise up, he used art to attack the Nazis, to expose the Nazis, and also there he's attacking the bourgeois newspapers. And there's attacking the fact that Hitler is based on money and he's got money as a backbone, etc. Swallows gold and spouts junk from 1932. And so, and if you think of the period of the time of the Weimar Republic, you'll see that people like George Gross was showing the society was driven by huge inequality. You often go through pictures, you always have the capitalists are gambling, showing the capitalist system with the stock market just gambling money away, they're rich and debauched. And this scenes of streets is often full of old soldiers begging, usually handicapped ex-soldiers begging for money because of the collapse of the economy in Germany, etc. So the art reflected those revolutionary periods at that time. Do you want to go on to that? And then also later in the 1930s, again, with very volatile times to the world, you have the movement of the Surrealist movement. Surrealism was to do to looking at the subconscious and the conscious to show the the reality behind it all. But again, the surrealists were a movement. They issued a manifesto, which was talking about the revolution in arts. But what people didn't realize at the time, that was in fact written by Trotsky, who used to write a lot on art and involved in debates in Russia. But also the surrealists were a movement, and you had to apply to join, and you could be expelled from the wrong politics. They expelled Salvador Dali, for example, for being so reactionary. And of course, they became friends with the fascists in Spain. And the surrealism applied and joined to the Fourth International. They became they officially were part of the Fourth International. So there you can see a direct link between what was the most avant-garde art at the time with politically involved with the politics of the time and identifying with and working with Trotsky. Okay. If you look at more recent times, talk about Grayson Perry, because he's quite interesting since he, for the 21st century. Start with, I think what he has to say about art is very, I think he's as good a critic of art as he is a practitioner. If you look at his pots of his early work, when he was at art college in the 1980s, a lot of his work, when you think of the 1980s, the miners' strike, Margaret Thatcher, a lot of his early work was actually attacking Margaret Thatcher and doing art performances, lampooning her and in drag about her. And his pottery has always been very, very aware of class and the nuances of class in British society, and how his works, or his current works on TV, have been showing how ordinary people can do art and try to break down the barriers of art just being for this elite intellectuals and who've just put art into the galleries, which are these beautiful cube white areas. There's also been a movement for many, many years to get art to the people, art onto the streets. Or art to be a performance. Jeremy Deller is another artist who, unlike many artists of the generation, doesn't do art about himself. That isn't necessarily awful, but he's always about movements of other people. His most famous performance piece is, of course, reenacting the Battle of Orgreave. And his later, when he did his show in Venice and Biennale, he was attacking the Range Rover and attacking the sort of Chelsea upper middle classes. And again, somebody whose art is about class struggle, is about class, and is about engaging with, reflecting and commenting on class society and the class war as it happens, as he experiences it. Can we go to the next slide? And taking art out into the street, as of course has got a history. You're seeing here various examples of public street art, and you can find it in Ireland, the famous wall paintings about the IRA and the struggle for Irish unification of Ireland and expelling the oppression of the British state out of Ireland. And you can also see there some of the great public art murals in Mexico, which came up after the revolution in Mexico. And again, interesting, we started off with Banksy, how Banksy came from the tagging and the graffiti movement or the street art movement that started in New York. And something else that's typical about art when it merges from below is all the arts tend to come out together. So Banksy came from the sort of what became the hip hop scene of New York, where it was body popping, it was dance, it was hip hop toasting, it was music, and it was graffiti, was part of the whole black experience in Brooklyn and New York in the 80s, then later in LA, and how Banksy comes from that political art movement where art should be on the streets. Why are the streets full of adverts? We should be able to own these streets. Whose streets are there? Our streets. We can own them by tagging on them. Banksy has gone on to make political statements. The one on Oscar Wilde is typical. There we have examples from what's on the wall that's in divide Palestine from Israel. There's lots of things around Palestine and the plight of the Palestinians and the ones who've done the wall and raising money for them, etc. So Banksy is typically anti-establishment. He's taken the street attacking world into a more political direction. I mean, some people have seen him, like Banksy has got his critics that say that what he's doing is he started off being radical and by streets for the people on the streets, but now he's become so fashionable that he now is just creating a different world to become, to sell out. Because of course, the ruling class as well as oppressing people can co-opt them as well. It can co-opt movements such as art movements very easily. The new revolutionary art movements become the new establishment. And so you place one establishment with another. Again, Trotsky wrote about this quite well, how bourgeois society can tame revolts against the establishment and make it into the new establishment. And simply say that's exactly what Banksy is doing. Rather than going to art school, he's providing an alternative way just to become another establishment, another way of not encouraging revolt, but to not exactly suppressing it, but to absorbing it and colluding with the state by allowing his paintings to be sold like that. And that's what it's about. I think they're wrong, but that is an ultra left critique of Banksy. Slide, anything else? Is that it?
I'm pretty sure the next slide is for Zach. That's you there, unless you've got any closing words. We'll be coming back to you shortly, Noel. But I think that's a really brilliant point to end on, you know, the possibility of things being co-opted. I think it's certainly something we could talk about in the discussion. But I want to come to you now, Zak, because of course, you're an activist in Love Music, Hate Racism. And we saw there with what Noel finished up with was really art coming out onto the streets, out of the gallery. And we know that it can come in many forms, you know, i.e. soundtracks to struggle, music, dance, and so on, which is something that I know you're particularly interested in. And of course, we saw the subway tagging in New York, linking in with hip hop and so on, which is of course inherently linked to those. So I guess I want to come to you now, where things like culture, particularly in the anti-racist struggle, are now more important more than ever in the wake of Black Lives Matter and so on. So I was wondering if you could offer us a little bit of an analysis and some examples of protest art and culture, particularly in the anti-racist struggle.
I think civil rights is a perfect place to start. So if we could play Billie Holiday's Strange Fruit, I think that'd be a brilliant place to start.
For the wind to suck, for the sun. strange and bitter crop.
What such a sad and amazing song. So over to you, Zak.
Thank you. I think any talk of the civil rights really has to start with Billie Holiday, because she's often widely seen as a massive spark for the civil rights movement. Crucially, to turn your attention to, on Saturday, there's a documentary In Search of Billie Holiday that's being put out with over 200 hours of interviews and documentary that's been put into colour. So do watch that programme as well. But to put this in a bit of a context, Strange Fruit was actually written by, Abel Meeropol, was a teacher and poet in 1937, who was horrified in Indiana at the lynchings that were the worst kept secret. This was happening in the South, but nothing was being done of it, and people were turning their eyes away from this. So this was his way of expressing the horrific racial violence that was happening. Now, the words are so emotive and powerful, absolutely graphic description of racist violence in America at the time. And what's true to say is Billie Holiday was incredibly brave at the time. Remember, this is 16 years before Rosa Parks refused to get off the bus. She was incredibly brave to turn that poem into a song. But what it did was absolutely not allow anyone any further to turn the other cheek away from lynchings in America. And it was a rallying cry for anti-racists across the country, which is why it's widely seen as the spark of the civil rights movement. And now what we have are some other brilliant examples. Nina Simone, that Sophia started with in the introduction that you were listening to, lots of powerful songs on experiences of suffering of Black people in the US. Sam Cooke, for any of you have recently seen A Night in Miami, Regina King's directorial debut, which was him in conversation in a hotel room with Malcolm X, Muhammad Ali, and the NFL legend Jim Jones, and really understanding where Sam Cooke was forced in a position to tell the story of the civil rights, that Black people were being killed in America. And out of that came A Change Is Gonna Come, an absolute fantastic song we associate with the civil rights as well. I put Jimi Hendrix on there as well, because he's another crucial example. The Star Spangled Banner at Woodstock was an absolute rage against the ills of society as well. And there's countless more. Aretha Franklin's You Make Me Feel and Respects, Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. The sound, it is what Sophia started with, really, to describe it as the soundtrack of the civil rights struggle. It gave hope to so many people, and there was a dialectical relationship, actually, with artists and like I gave the example of Sam Cooke, but Ray Charles as well, were forced to really take a side, really, the racist violence of the state, or actually do a music that spoke to people's struggles in the streets. And it was absolutely a driving force. We've got Martin Luther King here now. The staple singers toured with him to motivate and inspire demonstrations during the civil rights movements as well. So it was absolutely crucial at the time. And could I go to the next slide? Noel's already made the point about the birth of hip hop. I think it's absolutely crucial to look at the politics. The civil rights in some ways were a lot easier to see, the kind of clear politics of the civil rights. Whereas hip hop, I think for some people, particularly some of the attacks hip hop faced as being nihilistic, as being non-political at the time, particularly in the 80s and 90s, it was very much political. This was a voiceless and faceless marginalized communities in cities of America actually finding their voice. So in 1973, DJ Cool Herc at a house party in South Bronx isolated and repeated musical breaks to lay the foundation of what we know as modern day hip hops. And as Noel said, it was a culture, underground culture that involved beatboxing, that involved body popping, and street art and tagging was absolutely crucial for people to reclaim spaces they wouldn't otherwise be able to go to and give themselves a face. And it also was crucially about communicating the economic and social conditions they were living under. Let's not forget, in 1973, you had a Nixon government. By the time the 80s, you had a Reagan government that were very much trying to roll back on some of the gains of the civil rights movement. So the music was about speaking to that. The most radical examples, I'll end on this point for this section, was Public Enemy, who opened black radical position against the state. Fight the Power was a fantastic album that was used in Spike Lee's, probably his best films, Do the Right Thing, that showed racism and the reaction to it in the city of America. Okay, the next slide I want to turn to really is the history of struggle of anti-colonial struggles, history of opposition against racism and resistance to colonialism. Peter Fryer, you'll know, wrote one of the most brilliant anti-racist books, Stay in Power, The History of Black People in Britain. But one of the other perhaps less known books he wrote was on the experience of resistance against racism in Brazil. It's Rhythms of Resistance, African Musical Heritage in Brazil, which charts the emergence of capoeira, drumming and clapping, but he traces back to Angola. It was very much a training method for black slaves in the late 15th century when the Portuguese arrived. They were training ready, learning practices of fighting, ready for insurrection and guerrilla warfare. This is very much the root of where it comes from. We look at Trinidad. The image on the left is from Trinidad. Steel pan, stick fighting was outlawed by the British authorities precisely because it was a way of blacks practicing fighting techniques to use against the British. So steel pan was born as a way of ritualizing the resistance against the oppression. How has it survived so crucially on? Well, firstly, with the birth of carnival, which initially was probably brought by the Spanish and French to Trinidad, but droves of free black slaves soon saw off lots of the right white rulers, and it became a kind of mass event. It was a couple of days where society would be turned on its heads, and it led to some quite mass struggles. In 1881, the Camberley riots was open pitch battles between police and the masqueraders in Trinidad as well. And this culture, is it a surprise in Britain in the 1950s and beyond with the level of racism that Claudia Jones, a communist, saw it as such a good fit for London? And the image on your screen is from Darkest Hounds Band, that was an openly renegade boys. It started in Trinidad and came to Britain. This is them showing solidarity with the Zapatistas movement. And very early on, carnival was enthusiastically taken up by the West Indian communities as a way of showing resistance against racist oppression and discrimination. And is it any wonder then, like in Trinidad, the state were so concerned about it? So in 1976, the numbers drastically grew to 250,000 people. At this stage, from the 1975 carnival to the 1976, which is in this image there, the police went from 200 to almost 2,000 police officers under the guise that they were looking for pickpockets. This led to mass struggle where over 100 police were hurt or in hospital and lots of arrests as well. But this was quite a crucial battle ahead of the riots that would go on into the 80s. After this, the police called for the use of riot shields that were used for the first time at the Battle of Lewisham. I wanted to make the point because there's an argument with Carnival now that it was quite political in the 70s, but now it's commercialised and lost all its roots. And in recent years, the solidarity with Grenfell has been absolutely crucial. And it shows you that within culture, no matter how commercialised it can become, art forms will reflect wider society and the social political issues that are going on in wider society. So the anger at the horrific deaths and neglect of the citizens of Grenfell Tower spilled out into artistic solidarity in the 2017 Carnival. Again, in 2018, a solidarity with the Windrush was absolutely crucial. I'm going to move on to Black Lives Matter now, because I think I'm running out of time. Now, there's been several waves of Black Lives Matter demonstrations. What I found remarkable about this one, often, and in Britain as well, the image of Black Lives Matter is a photo of the person who's been murdered by the police. I think what's been so crucial about this time actually is the use of graffiti street art. Actually, one of the key images has been, like you've got on your screen, is the graffiti art of George Floyd. I think has been absolutely crucial. We've also seen Breonna Taylor and Ahmaud Arbery as well. And of course, this latest development in Black Lives Matter is the biggest anti-racist movement now in British history, the biggest in American history as well, even surpassing the civil rights movement. What has been crucial is the level of international solidarity has gone to another level. This image is from Naples. We've got the image of Lenin, MLK, Malcolm X, Angela Davis alongside George Floyd. These other images, there, one from Karachi, from Nairobi, from Syria as well. Again, as Noel mentioned before, reclaiming spaces, showing solidarity, saying the name of people being murdered, and linking with other issues of working class people across the globe, struggles against imperialism, has been absolutely crucial to these struggles. Now, in Britain, in Bristol, one of our symbols has been the taking down of the Colston statue. Was an absolutely fantastic symbolic act. So I've put up here Jem Foster, which didn't last very long, but it raised, really, again, I think a brilliant example of where art and mass movements work in tandem. Actually, quite an artistic act of pulling Edward Colston down raised huge questions for the British state of their slavery past, the lack of black statues as well, was brilliant issues. And we're seeing this also with the climate movement as well. The use of art alongside mass movement, very, very powerful. What does art do? I'll end really on a John Molyneux point that he made, is that art is a snapshot of a wider society. This is why Marxists should take it so seriously. John Molyneux had an anecdote about going to the Sistine Chapel. He said the young Michelangelo, you can see in his art, was very positive about the Renaissance. By an older Michelangelo, as the Renaissance was in decline, this was reflected in his art as well. Art tells us a lot where we're at in terms of the struggle against capitalism. It's inextricably, as Noel said, culture and politics are inextricably linked to each other. It's crucial then that we take them both seriously. I'll stop there.
Thank you so much for that, Zak, and both to Noel. So I guess I've got one more question for you both, and then we'll open it up to discussion. I know I gave you guys 3 minutes in the planning, but maybe a little bit more brief so we have as much time for discussion and so on. And I'm sure these questions will come out in the contributions and in your summing up. But of course, the title of this meeting is Can Art Change the World? I think we've seen today, both in the forms of fine art, but music and street art and so on, how art can be an expression of this resistance. And of course, a critique of society, but can it create the society that it really envisions on its own? And I'd like to ask you, how can socialists, whether they be artists or not, actually bring about the end of capitalism and racism, which has been critiqued so much in the artwork that we've seen today? And also, how can we organize in order to change the world where art isn't just a commodity or a cry of the oppressed even, but rather an expression of creativity which is accessible to all people people all across the world. So I'm going to come back to you, Noel, and then back to Zak, and we'll open it up for discussion. But let's try keep it brief so we can have as much time for discussion and so on. So over to you, Noel, about how can art change the world?
Well, art can wake people up. Art can make people aware. Art can enthuse people, can be part of the struggle. But in and of itself, it won't change society. We've seen many cases where revolutionary art movements have risen and they become the next establishment. Again, Trotsky was very well describing this, how by encouraging certain art movements, it can completely neutralize the radical element of it. It just becomes the next big thing, just the next fashion thing to do. Again, I think Grayson's very good at describing that, what happened in the 80s. And what is it in the 21st century, how all these oh so radical art movements can just become a new way of becoming a successful artist. And in a good example is in America. In America, there are very, very few art galleries where black people can get their art show. And this has been true a very long time. In fact, there was going to be a good show in MoMA until the pandemic risen, which was going to show there's a famous space where black art couldn't be shown in galleries. So some of these community centers started to show art and then became the basis of a lot of quite would now seem as very important black art from the 1960s and 70s. And MoMA was going to have a retrospective celebrating that until maybe last year, but it got shut down. Presumably it might come back again. But because of that, there have grown up alternative ways of showing black art. I mean, one we've looked at already, the sort of street art, but there have been some black galleries, black gallery owners have set up spaces to show black art. But that is not going to do anything other than just be another series of art. It's not going to change the system. It's just getting into the system. And the other way it's grown up because of that exclusion of black artists in America is that there's grown up an alternative way of developing your art. So there's a series of artists in America now who start off by designing t-shirts and trainers and do music. And so it becomes just that sort of creating commodities, but not via the art scene, but via the sort of pop scene or trainer and t-shirt scene. And then they also develop onto the art as well. But again, that's an alternative way of becoming an artist. It's not restructuring society, which is much bigger than just art can deal with or cope with. It can certainly be the center of struggle, but in of itself, it can be bought off and radical artists can become tamed, or the art itself becomes tamed and lose its radical critique.
Thanks for that, Noel. We'll be able to hear back from you after the discussion. And over to you, Zak, as well. Can art change the world? And if not, how do we change it to the one that we want it to be like?
I just wanted to start with a couple of important other references I haven't mentioned. I think, as you've got on the screen, Rock Against Racism was a crucial movement that combined both artistic form, anti-racist artistic form, with the kind of call out to stop the growth of the National Front on the street as well. It's another brilliant example. In the fanzines, temporary hoardings, it pointed away another kind of society as well. Incredibly political and successful campaign that drew back the National Front. The other thing I wanted to mention quickly is art in the Egyptian Revolution. This was where a revolution of sort was achieved. Hosni Mubarak was deposed. The art, like on screen at the moment, was an absolute crucial part of it. But it comes back to a point that we probably started with, was have workers, as our key role of workers, gain the means of producing things in society. Without that, art will always be a commodity. It will always be disconnected. Human creativity will always be disconnected in more than it just a glimpse or a snapshot on our ability to control our lives. So our role as workers, the lifeblood of this system of turning off the tap, of turning off the blood from the vampire capitalists that suck of it, is where our true power lies. Art can express, can encourage that, but ultimately that is where worker power lies. And the best art will play a role in that struggle. It will tell the story of that struggle. But mass revolutionary action is what will change the world, not just solely art.